I would like to start to welcome you all, first by welcoming you all to this webinar. My name is Sybrand van Bijma. I am working at CloudFero as a remote sensing data expert, and as such, I am quite regularly giving webinars about potential uses of the Creodios platform. So I would like to focus today on Sensorcap. So first, the agenda for today. I will start talking a bit about CloudFero and Creodios. Then I will focus a bit on the use of Sensorcap software or the Sensorcap software in general. Then I would like to tell a bit more about how Sensorcap is integrated on the Creodios platform. And I will spend most of the time of this presentation on a live demo of Sensorcap examples as using it on Creodios. For people that have been attending the webinar end of August, about 2 months ago, this is pretty much a rerun of the same webinar. I will talk a bit about the updates of the Sensorcap system, but on the whole, it's fairly the same story. If you have any questions during the webinar, please feel free to post those in the chat box. And we have two moderators, Sylvia Nazirovska, I should say, and Marcin Białecki, who can help and answer your questions during the webinar already. And I will, after the live demo, also run a Q&A session and briefly go through the questions that might not have been answered, or to take some questions. So I will start with my presentation. First a bit about CloudFero. Who are we? CloudFero, we can call it now a European private technology company, founded in 2015, headquartered in Warsaw in Poland. But as you can see on the map of Europe, there's already presence in three countries. So besides Poland, that's also Germany and the United Kingdom. CloudFero is a provider of cutting-edge computing services and focusing a lot on the European space data sector. They're focusing on the uses of big data sets, like multi-petabyte repositories of Earth observation satellite data. It's one of the leading cloud service providers for the European space sector. As you can see, it's growing quite nicely. There was a 66% revenue growth in 2019 compared to 2018. So the company is growing quite quickly. Then I will focus on Creodios. Creodios is one of the cloud computing platforms that's managed by CloudFero. There's more. CloudFero is also involved in the Wekio platform, which is one of the other DIAS platforms, but also the CodeDA platform from the German Aerospace Center, and a few others as well. But Creodios is one of the five DIAS platforms, which stands for Data, Information and Access Services, which is an initiative initiated by the European Commission to build European cloud computing platforms for the utilization of processing of satellite data, primarily from the Copernicus program. So on the Creodios platform, there's direct access to the full archives of the Sentinel repository, Sentinel 1, 2, 3, 5P, and soon 6, that was launched last week. We provide access to the Copernicus surface data. So you have the C3S, which is the climate change data, CAMS, atmospheric data, CEMS, which is, I always get confused, emergency mapping. CLMS is land monitoring service, and the CMEMS, which is the marine environment monitoring service. So all these Copernicus service data is also present on the Creodios platform, or at least if it's not there, it can be ordered and we can make sure it's being put on the platform. That's also what I would like to stress, is that it's not a static platform. We have often users that are interested in certain data sets, and we can provide a way to integrate this data set so it can be accessed by users or end users of the platform. Besides the Copernicus data, we have ancillary data, mostly DEM data, but also data from non-Sentinel missions or non-European missions like Landsat. Well, ESMOS is a European, and Envisat as well, European missions, but they're more specific as well. And we also have now a few contracts with some very high resolution data providers like Yilin, Kaseyosat, and CompSat. So those data sets can also be made available through our platform. At the moment, I checked yesterday, we have 19.7 petabyte of data. So almost 20 petabyte of data now. And as there's more data recorded every day, it's growing. The data can be accessed through APIs, can be used through a GUI, like you can see the screenshot on the right, which is the Creodios Finder, where you can, a bit more like a traditional data search engine where you can search for data and download it there as well. Any registered user can download data from our platform. You don't even need to have a paid for subscription. You just need to register. So that's the data is freely available to download. But you can the idea of the cloud computing platform is that you can process it on the cloud platform itself without the need to download data. So for that, we have a wide range of different types of virtual machines that can be used. So we offer very scalable computing services and flexible billing options as well. Then we'd like to move on to a little background introduction to the Sen4Cap software. So the Sen4Cap software is the CAP stands for Common Agricultural Policy. It's European Union policy, which aims at improving agricultural productivity and ensuring a decent standard of living for farmers within the EU. So, it is currently in a reform, in a modernization process, the CAP, Earth observation data has been acknowledged as or recognized as a very useful tool, data source for checking and checking compliancy to the CAP policy, the CAP requirements, and it will also make it more cost efficient is the expectations. So the Sen4Cap project is initiated to facilitate this uptake of satellite data for the CAP. By providing algorithms, products, and workflows, that will help the monitoring and management of the CAP. So more information can be found on the web link below. So the Sen4Cap software package can generate a number of products. This is, first of all, you can calculate a cultivated crop type map, which is a discrimination of crop types or crop type groups. This is based on, the system will need some input data to build this crop type map. It uses a number of advanced machine learning algorithms to classify satellite data into crop type maps. And so the second product that they have available is a grassland mowing product. So it can discriminate grass mowing events per parcels or per agricultural field. Let's go to the third one. There's a vegetation status indicator, so it can this is more a maps of the status of vegetation, how healthy it is. So it's more the traditional I would say vegetation indices like NDVI, but also more advanced modern biophysical products like LAI, fraction of cover, that can be created, that can be calculated by the CenferCap software. Then we have the product of the agricultural practices monitoring product, which means the identification of agricultural practices of crop harvesting and plowing of grasslands, as well as comparison of farmer declarations of fallow lands or the growing of catch crop nitrogen fixing crops against EO data. That's nicely read, this definition there. So it's quite a wide range as well. They are at the moment also integrating a new product, which is a tillage detection. And this will be available in the latest version, or in the new upcoming version, which is foreseen to be released in January. So how does the system work? Because it basically is a automated ingester of large numbers of satellite data, which are either Sentinel-1 radar data or optical data from the Sentinel-2, as well as the Landsat-8 satellites. After ingesting this, the system can apply atmospheric correction to the optical data sets. So they are converted from level 1 to level 2 products. And for the SAR, the Sentinel-1 data, it calculates terrain corrected backscatter as well as coherence time series. So these are quite complex calculations. The system runs this completely automated, from these level 2 products, these are used to calculate the higher level products that I mentioned in the previous slide. So the crop type mapping, the grassland mowing detectors, etc. Now we'll talk a little bit about the integration of CenferCap on the Creodius platform. We have built a custom-built CenferCap virtual machine image, which means this is basically a ready-made image of a installation of CenferCap, which by any user of the Creodius platform can start a virtual machine with this image and have all the software installed and ready to use. The big advantage of using CenferCap on Creodius is that we do store the complete European collections of Sentinel-1, Sentinel-2, and Landsat-8 data. We also start to have more and more users of the CenferCap software that are focusing on areas outside Europe. In that case, we have a need to download some data, usually from the Landsat repository, but also the Sentinel long-term archives. Those systems are now already in place, and we can download quite quickly all the data to our repository. So this means that the data is sitting basically next to the software, there's no need to download the satellite data through the quite often slow official data hubs. We provide, as I mentioned already earlier, we have scalable storage and computing solutions. So if you need to process a lot of data, you can enlarge or use a more powerful virtual machine with a larger storage capacity. If you are less in need of big data processing, you can scale it down easily. We provide active support with regard to technical CenferCap related issues, or we can forward queries to the CenferCap developers if we also don't know the technical solutions completely. Which I also mentioned in the last point, with direct communication with the experts, the developers, if there are any specific technical issues. This I will show also in the live demo, but I quickly want to show a bit what this CenferCap image is. So in this image, we have included installation of all the necessary software to run CenferCap. So besides CenferCap, you have the Maya software, but also PostgreSQL, Apache, etc. It runs on a CentOS 7 operating system, and we have a GUI included as well, so you can easily run it. You can visualize the virtual machine quite well. It doesn't need to be all command line based. The Stanford Cap software is so set directly so that the access to the Sentinel 1 and 2 and Landsat data repositories are ready to use. There's no need to update the system, so it will know where the data sits. The ancillary data that's necessary for Stanford Cap, which is the SRTM and the SWBD, so the water body data that's needed for the Maya processing, are included. These are quite large data sets, but they're already on the image. Yeah, and it's ready to be used by for example, X2Go client, which is which I will show in the live demo as well, which is a way to access a virtual machine in a GUI version, so through a graphical user interface. So what we offer is that we provide always the latest version of Stanford Cap. We are at the moment updating to version 1.3, we expect that to be that image to be busy to be ready soon enough for any existing users that are interested in upgrading to 1.3. We can provide easy installation scripts to run this upgrade. We also provide a flexible billing model for Stanford Cap users, what I mentioned earlier. If you need more power, computing power, more storage, we can scale you up. If you need less, then we can scale you down. We have EO data, remote sensing data expert, and sales support as well. We make sure that the data set is always all the Copernicus data is up to date. It is basically a mirror of the official Sci-Hub or the Copernicus Hub data. So all the Sentinel 1 and 2 data is there, as well as the Landsat data, but then for coverage of Europe. But yeah, as I mentioned, we can also order and download the data for outside Europe. And we also offer customized contracts if needed. So we have more information on the webpage. There's two links below. So further information, please contact our sales expert for Stanford Cap, which is Marcin Białecki. And technical support can be found under support@cloudfero.com. So this was the introduction into Stanford Cap and how Stanford Cap is integrated on the platform. So I would like to switch now to a live demo, which will consist of three parts. We'll quickly run through the installation and setting up the virtual machine with Stanford Cap. Then I will show how a Stanford Cap project can be started. And then I will also focus on analyzing a number of processing results, which I generated in the last few days. So I will end my presentation for the moment and make it small and go to my browser. That's this one. So I will go first to the, Oh, wait a minute. I would like to, okay, there you go. So here I'm on the web, the homepage of Creodeus. There you go. I've already logged in. That step has been done automatically. So if I would like to start a virtual machine with Stanford Cap, I can go to my cloud environment, and then I will log into my console that any Creodeus user will see. Here I can set up a virtual machine, change a virtual machine, delete the virtual machine or shelve it if you're done with using it. So this is where you can manage all your virtual machines. So if I go now to instances here, you can see a number of virtual machines that are currently running under my account. So if I want to start a new one with Stanford Cap, I can go to the button launch instance and I can build one. So I will give it a name that makes sense. of the 26th of November. And I will go to the next. And here, I will show you here the virtual machine images that are all available to users of Creodios. So there's quite a long list nowadays already. So you can use a Windows virtual machine or Ubuntu or CentOS. And here's the one with Zen4Cap. So I select that one, activate it with the button to the top. You can see it's now here at the top. I can go to the next one. And now I have to choose a virtual machine flavor, as they call that. So basically, what kind of machine does it need to run, and what kind of, how powerful does it need to be? How much RAM do you need? How many vCPUs? So Zen4Cap does need some RAM. It does need some storage space. These values are related to the root disk. If you need bigger storage, you can easily attach a volume to this virtual machine, which can be used for storage of data. But this is just a root disk, so where all the software is located on and is running from. So I decide to take the HMX Large, which is big enough for Zen4Cap. So it's selected here at the top again. And we can go to the next one here. We need to set which networks I'm using. So I take this private network and also EO data, which is very important. So I connect the virtual machine directly to the EO data repository, which is the data server where all the satellite data is stored. The private network is a way to connect with the VM to the outside world, if I'm completely right about that, but it needs to be selected as well. Then we have a few security groups which I need to set, right? I mean, this is very standard. There's a very good tutorials on the website which tell you, and now we also have some YouTube movies that can explain new users and how to set up a virtual machine. So this might look very technical, but it's not that complex, and there's always the support that can help you. So now we need to have a key pair, which is basically a password to access the virtual machine. I take this one, which I use often for Zen4Cap. And then there's a few steps which I don't really need to change anything for now. So I'll go to the end and then launch instance. And now I get already on the top a message that it's a success. The instance is launched. And at the moment it's spawning, which means it's starting up. It's being installed or built, basically the virtual machine. This takes about a minute or so, and not much longer. And there you go. Well, that was less than a minute. And now I can almost start using my virtual machine. I just need to assign a floating IP. A floating IP IP is an internet protocol. It's basically just the address of the virtual machine, which is the access point to the way to access the virtual machine from the outside. So I will need to select an IP address. I think this is the wrong code, so I need to make a new IP address available. And it's thinking now. And I expect it to be done very shortly. There you go. And that needs to be connected to the Zen4Cap. The IP address starts with 192. And then if I associate it should be ready to use after this. Always takes like 20 seconds, half a minute. I hope it works in a live demo. There you go. Phew. always exciting when it works. So I can use this floating IP now to access the virtual machine. I copy it. I can do that in a browser, but it takes a few minutes for the IP to be registered, so it can be used through the internet directly. I've learned from the previous webinar. So I will go instead to X2Go. X2Go is a software to access virtual machines or other external computers through a number of protocols. Don't pin me down on the specifics. I'm not an IT expert. But for that, I will need to make a new connection. So I put as a host here the IP address that I just copied. The login should always be EO user. I can give it a name. I just do it send for cap. And then today's date. I need to also define here which key I am using to access it, which I also defined in the setting up of the virtual machine, and in what kind of GUI environment I'm using. Well, we have the XFCE installed on the send4cap image, so that should be good. So here I just say okay, and then I see there's a new connection right here. I click it, then it asks me, do I trust the host key? Yes, I do. And then it will hopefully create a connection. And there you go, connected. And then we will, it always takes also like 20 seconds to start up, to build the connection. And there we go, we have a connection to the virtual machine that I just created. So I will use a default config. So here's just the desktop Linux environment, but it looks fairly friendly, not some scary command line. I would like to show here quickly the send4cap, how it looks like, so you can go to a browser. We have Firefox installed on the virtual machine, but you can install any browser that you would like to. For the first time, it always takes a few seconds to start up. But there you go. Some standard tabs that you get. I just take a new one and I just type in localhost and press enter. And there you go. Here's the send4cap platform ready to use. I can use the login, which is standard send4cap with password send4cap for a new installation. Any user can make a new account and change the password to make it a bit more difficult. But here we have the platform all ready to go with all the tabs that can be used for users. So that's how simple it is to set up a send4cap virtual machine. So that's what I would like to show here. Now, instead of starting a project here, I would like to change to a other virtual machine that I started 3 days ago and it's been sent for cap, and I've been running some processing on. So I can show some processing results, and there I can also show how to start a new project, for example. In the meantime, we might as well just see if we can use this IP that I had before. Let me copy it again. The IP address that I, let's see if it's already registered. There you go. So now I use this, just copy and paste this IP address to the browser. And there I can access my virtual machine through a browser, which is great if you're not really interested in diving under the hood for it's great to show users how the system is working, for example, without having to deal with difficult setups through X2Go and so on. So that's a very neat way to access the platform. So, but I would like to show a bit more advanced results. So I go to my other Stanford CAP virtual machine that I started a few days ago in X2Go, and I start it up again. And there you go. Connection has been restored. And there we go. Here's my other virtual machine. I go to the browser again, Firefox. And let it start. And then type in, instead of all this, CentOS, open page, localhost. And there I can log into the Stanford CAP platform yet again. And as you can see here, there's already, I just would like to show quickly how we can start a new processing site. So if you see, there's already one here defined here, NL, so it's in the Netherlands. There's some good sample data that that's available on the Stanford CAP platform with sample data of the Netherlands, a big chunk of the Netherlands. With field polygons, field and also actual CAP declaration data. So it's very good to test and to show how the system works. So I will, just for the sake of it, I will create a new site which I call NL2, because I will have to, I will use the same sample data. So here I select a shapefile which defines my site extent. So this is basically just a polygon. So I can now save a new site, and I can edit the site. And it, from the extent file that I sent, it already identified which Sentinel-2 tiles. So 31 UFU and 31 UFT are covered by the site of interest, area of interest. As well for the Landsat 8, the tiles, the row and path numbers. So 198 and 199, 024, 024. So yeah. So they're also automatically identified from the area of extent. And here I can add a new season, which I will quickly do. So I'm interested in, for example, I call it 2020. And I'm interested in looking at satellite data that's my growing season, covers my growing season from, let's say, the 1st of April this year through to, let's say, June, it was the mid of the season, until the 1st of August this year. I would like to enable this site. And here is a list of processors I can use. I can use L3B, which is the vegetation status data, so the LAI, NDVI data that can be calculated. And here we have the level 4 products, they call it the crop type, the grassland mowing, the agricultural practices data. You can set it that it automatically processes the data, but you can also run it later. So I'll leave it off for now. I just want to show how this works. I press the save button here. And in order to start processing the data, I just enable the site again and click save site. And then it will need a minute. And there you go. Your site has been successfully modified. So that's good. The system now starts to search for data that corresponds to the area of interest and the period of interest. So the Netherlands between the 1st of April 2020 and the 1st of August 2020. It will, because we're on the Creodis platform, not download the data, but it will create a symbolic link to the data, or a direct link these days, and then it will run the different processors. So for the optical data, Sentinel-2, Landsat 8, it will calculate atmospheric correction. And then for the Sentinel-1, it will calculate terrain-corrected backscatter and coherence data. So here we can see the data sources. We have a tab here for Creodios. It tells you that and it's enabled, so we would like to use Landsat 8, Landsat 8 data, which is stored on Creodios. And here are some settings, so we take a direct link to the product. And this is where you can find it on the network. So under the EO data directory, which is mounted to the virtual machine automatically, and then Landsat, and then the type of data. So this data, this is a real big advantage of using the Zenfocap platform or software on our Creodios platform. You can get a direct, you can directly start processing without any need to download the data. So if you go to system overview, please don't save. You can see it's slowly, it's still low, but in a few minutes or so, I expect the CPU usage to go up and it really starts to pre-process the data. So that's nice. So this will take a day, depending on how large an area you're interested in, how big, how long a period you're interested in. It will take a day, maybe 2 days, or 1.5 days to process all this data. And if you look at it, there is now about 880 products that are downloaded, or not downloaded, but there's direct links created and they will be pre-processed or be used for pre-processing. So we're talking already about a significant amount of data. That's that. And now I would like to go to my last step of the last part of my live demo. I would like to show some processing results. So for that, I have used the data that is processed in the first site, the NL site, not the NL2 that I just created, but the NL site. There's already a list of products that have been processed. So here you see the level 2A atmospheric correction data. There's a long list of Sentinel-2 and Landsat 8 data that's been pre-processed. As, based on those optical data, we have a lot of level 3, the LAI data. If I click on one, you can see a brief screenshot. So this is quite a cloudy image that has been created. Yeah, it's the Netherlands, so you expect a lot of clouds. And here you see it's just a quick screen dump of the data. But you also see there's a list of Sentinel-1 level 2 amplitude data, which I can also click on, and then you see also a simple screen dump. The screen dumps are not fantastic, I should say, but you can see that there's data. Let's take one more. Yeah. And also you can see here I have created some level 2A crop type products and also level 4B grassland mowing products. So I would like to take a quick look at these two products. I've simply opened them in QGIS, which I also installed on the virtual machine. So you can open the data directly in QGIS. So this is an example of the crop type data that I've loaded, as well as the grassland mowing data. So I quickly would like to look at this one. You can see here there's a very large range of different crops that are grown. It's unfortunately in Dutch, but fortunate for me. Please believe me that it's ranging from potatoes to corn to wheat to pumpkin. So a very, very diverse range of crops that are that are fed into the crop type mapping system. So what the crop type mapping does, it creates a classifier which is trained with a subset of the total set of input data, and then goes through all the satellite data adds the satellite data to the classifier, and then comes up for each parcel the likelihood based on the satellite data that this this declared crop is really there. It's one of the important checks for the CAP monitoring system. So here I changed this is the same data set, but I changed the setting. So all the green parcels are where the crop that's been declared is by the the crop type classifier has agreed to, yeah, this is, it's likely that this crop grows in this field. So anything green is conform and anything red is non-conform. So you see there's a few red. I have to say here that I've only used 2 months of data. So this classifier is probably not very reliable. The more data you feed, the more satellite data you feed into the system, the more reliable the results are, the more accurate they will be. So I can, for example, click on this red field here where it's red, which is non-conform. It's also funny that, let's try this one. I need to zoom in a little, that QGIS has a tendency to select a lot. So here you can see in the attributes, and then we go to the bottom and show, can I make this bigger? No, I need to just pull this a bit in. Yeah, there you go. So here the CT decal is the declared crop type. And that's a type, it's a numeric crop type. It's a, but there's also a, that's expressed in numbers, but the declared crop type is crop type number 153. And according to the system, they predict that it would be crop type 3000 that's growing there. So that's why they say it's non-conform. And for any user of the platform, these are the fields to be interested in to see what's going on there. It might be that if you feed more satellite data into the system, it will change to conform. So that's something that's always useful. I just processed 2 months as an example. So much for the crop type mapping. I'll make this small again, and this one a bit bigger. And then I have the second product, which is the grass on mowing area. So here, all the parcels, you see there's fewer parcels visible here. And these are all the parcels that were identified as grassland by the system. And the different colors correspond to different dates where the system thinks, yeah, it's quite likely that a mowing event took place on this date. And so you see the different colors. Anything red is quite early. That's the 3rd of May. And anything more towards blue, we go through green to blue, is by the 17th of June. So in this period, and the system identified like this, it's likely there is a mowing event in this period. So you can see, also this is only 2 months worth of data, although this processor works in a different way, but yeah, you can get a good idea for what the dynamics are and for the CAP controllers and the paying agencies. It's very useful information. So with that, I it's already 2:45, so most of that time is gone already. I would like to end my live demo with this and go back to the presentation. So there you go. Let's go to end sharing and go back to the presentation. And then, so that's the live demo. Then I would like to alert to upcoming webinars on cloudflare.com/webinars. We regularly update the website with the latest upcoming webinar. So I would like to recommend everybody to regularly check. We have another one coming up on the 8th of December, which is run and go together with Cloud.io, the German cloud company. And please, all the links to subscribe are on the website there. So I would like to go now to the Q&A session. I will make my questions visible here and see if there's any questions that are not answered yet. So I will quickly run through them. Will the webinar be recorded? Yes, it's currently being recorded and it will be placed on YouTube on our official channel. A good question, is there a API to control send for CAP with Python? Martin has responded to that, to the Send for Cap manual, point 2.5. From the top of my head, there is, yeah, you can run the entire system through the command line. And so that's there's no need to use the GUI that I just showed. You can start the system, you can restart the system, you can assign a new area of interest, a period of interest. You can all do it through the command line. So in that sense, you can run it in Python. Yes, if you connect to the virtual machine through Python, which is possible, then submit a few commands to the virtual machine. So that should all be possible. Yeah. Question, where is the LPIS data imported from? That data that I used is just sample data that's provided by the Send for Cap consortium. If you would like to look for test data, yes, you can maybe look in the Inspire portal, which is already suggested, where you want to go. You can, but yeah, if you want to test the system, you can quite well use the sample data that's on the Send for Cap website. I can provide a link to that later as well. So it's just, yeah, but you need to upload LPIS data to start the processing this crop type and this grassland mowing data. And you need to have data that's in a certain format. It's all explained in the Send for Cap manual as well. And also I would like to refer to the Send for Cap forum, where there's a lot of technical questions being answered. There's also quite a wide range of information there. And you can always send us a message and then we can maybe figure it out ourselves or directly ask the developers. So that's that. Where's the next? Oh yeah, here we go now. Let's see if there's any more questions. Really, thank you. Yeah, are there any publications about the classification algorithms used in the crops? Yes, there are. There's detailed information on the Send for Cap website, which is Sylvia put the link to that as well. Yeah, they're all there. It's quite an extensive description, so you can find it on the website of Send for Cap as well. And that's a good question. What would be the Bastian? What would be the best, easiest way to combine Send for Cap and high resolution data on Creodios? Good question. I would say let's talk to us and me and Marcin, and then we can think of how to do it. There's ways to integrate planet data in Send for Cap, but we don't offer that on our platform, but I think there's definitely a way where we can figure this out, or maybe in conjunction with the Send for Cap developers as well, because they are also working on integration of several very high resolution data sets to this. So good to hear. Okay, that's the bottom of the questions. If you're interested, there's a lot of information on the chat, links as well. So if you want more information, have a good look. Which is, I would like to thank everybody who's still around for joining the webinar. If there's any questions, please feel free to send me an email or have a look on our website, cloudfair.com or creodios.eu. And at the bottom, you also see our Twitter, LinkedIn, and Facebook accounts. Not very clear, but if you just Google, you'll find us there as well. I would like to finish up with that. And thank you very much for your attention. And hopefully, you'll tune into a next webinar. Yeah.